27 years ago, and the first position that my husband took was in the sound ministry, and we were just engaged at the time, so of course I wanted to be by his side, so I started working the sound ministry with him, and I actually learned a thing or two about the sound ministry, because still to this day, 27 years later, I want to find myself wanting to fix the sound at church when it's ringing or when there's enough reverb and all that kind of thing. But from there, we went into youth ministry about 7 years, led a youth choir, took them on a choir tour with family ministry, worked as a church secretary for approximately 20 years, and whatever was church-related, we did it. Just assisted in about every capacity you could imagine. And then just over 2 years ago, actually 3 years now, we're in our third year, the Lord ordered our steps to take over the church in Beaumont, Texas, as senior pastors there. And everything was just so great and exciting, and I just, you know, I was just excited to be there, and it was just a great feeling. And then all of a sudden, this set of unworthiness set in my spirit. And I would find myself sitting in church, and instead of like, oh God, you're so worthy, I'd be like, I'm not worthy to be here. God, I don't even know how to minister to all these great people. And so this unworthy feeling was quickly growing into more of a debilitating feeling. It wasn't causing me to feel better. It wasn't a humble, oh God, I'm blessed to be here. It was a debilitating feeling. And it was growing into a defeated spirit. It's kind of like, the best way to describe it, when you come to music conference and you get all these new licks and tricks and you find all this stuff that you should be doing and the information overload and you're supposed to go home and you want to go home that weekend and put it all into practice and just completely revolutionize your music ministry. It's overwhelming. And that was the feeling that I was getting sitting in our own church. Even after 27 years of ministry and doing every aspect, I find myself sitting in this church feeling very unworthy. And then we had a family conference with Dr. James Hughes, and he said something, I know it was a God-ordered message, that hit me right where I needed to be hit. And he was talking about Ephesians 4 and 1, how Paul was writing to the church in Ephesus. And he said, I beseech you, I beg you to walk worthy of the calling. And Dr. Hughes said, if you dig around into that, the word worthy, he said, in Greek and Hebrew, the translations for worthy literally means balance. And so I'm begging you to walk in balance. And so what a revelation at that moment that I needed in our ministry. The Lord was asking me to walk in balance, not worthy of the calling. I felt literally a ton of weight just lift off of my shoulders because I can pray, I can fast, I can live a disciplined life, I can read my word. And so if that, I will do those things, walking in balance, studying, doing all that I can, then I'm walking worthy because I'm walking in balance. In prayer and fasting for this class, the Lord reminded me of a couple things. And when I was just a young teen, I thought to myself, I wonder how, you know, people who step up to sing solos or preach magnificent sermons, where does that anointing come from? It just, some of it seems just like an uncommon anointing, like, wow, you sit there and cry. And so I was just thinking to myself, and let me tell you that God knows every thought you think. He's concerned with just our very thoughts and the things that we feel. He's concerned about it. It was the very next Sunday in service, my pastor got up there. Nobody knew my thoughts that week about how do you get that anointing. And my pastor got up there and he said, you want to know how to get the anointing? He said, it's the life you live in secret. He said, it's the life when you're fasting and you're praying and you're before God that nobody knows about. It's your private life that will determine your public anointing. And then number two, successful people master their moods. Feelings of unworthiness are not God's tools. They are fleshly tools. God's tools are, if I do my part, he will do his. God's tools are, I can do all things through Christ who strengtheneth me. God's tools say, you know what, I've studied, I've prayed, I've fasted, I've practiced to I've done my best to walk in balance. I've given my tithe, I've given my offering, Lord. I've done everything on my part. Basically, I've done my best, and I'm going to let God do the rest. See, the fact of the matter is, as Dr. Hughes said, none of us will truly ever be worthy of the calling, but we can walk in balance. And my husband's going to come and talk about balance.
Thank you. It is an honor and a privilege to be here with you. And as my wife laid that foundation for you about what is worthy, it's about balance. And probably the greatest scripture in the Bible about balance comes from Deuteronomy chapter 6, not verse 4, but verse 5. Verse 4 is the beginning of what they call the Hebrew Shema, the center focal point of the Hebrew scripture. But when we look at verse 5, it says, to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy might. And it goes on and it talks about how we take that and we implement it into our children, into our grandchildren, how we teach that to them. Jump into the New Testament. When they ask Jesus, what is the greatest commandment? He quotes Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, all thy soul, all thy might. And he has to love thy neighbor as thyself. And he says, everything in the Old Testament hangs upon these two laws. So everything we're taught in the Old Testament scripture, Jesus gives it to us in a synopsis version in two verses. To love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, thy soul, and thy mind. A very biblical approach to love him balanced. Anybody here have a mag flashlight? And a mag flashlight. I love mag flashlights. This flashlight has three batteries in it. Engineers tell you all you need is two batteries to make this thing shine as bright as it possibly can. So why do they put like three and four batteries in it sometimes? So that swings a whole lot better when you hit somebody with it. Yeah. Let me ask you a question. If we took three batteries and put them in this flashlight, and two of these batteries were good, and one of them was almost dead, or was dead, would the flashlight still work? Some of you are going, you debate it. Okay, some of you saying definitely no. Okay? You're right. If it was completely dead, it wouldn't work. Because why? It's designed to transfer energy. And if it's not going to have a complete circuit, it's not going to work. But if it's almost dead, it will work, but it will barely work. In fact, when you get a package of batteries, it will say on the package of batteries, do not mix new and old batteries. And it says that for a very good reason. Because if you get two good batteries, and you put a bad battery or a weak battery in there with it, what happens is this bad battery will suck the juice out of these two good batteries to make up for what it lacks. Okay? And so we take that analogy and apply it to us as God designed us and made us. The three batteries of life. The physical, emotional, and the spiritual. These are the three things that make us up who we are from a biblically holistic perspective. And don't let me throw you off that word holistic. It just means all of who you are, all of your creative being. Okay? And so every theorist, every doctor, every psychologist out there will tell you that man is made up of these three distinct parts, and it's what makes us function and makes us whole. And so it's important to understand these three affect one another. I just want to get into it real quick. Anybody here ever had the flu? Anybody get the flu here this season? You had the flu before? I mean, you get the puking, running to the restroom flu. Okay? I mean, you're deathly sick. The flu is 100% physiological. And it drains this battery down to almost nothing. What does it do to you emotionally? You're not the nicest person to be around, are you? You're cranky. You got a bad attitude, you're grumpy, you're critical, you're harsh, and it's just bad. What does it do to you spiritually? How's your prayer life doing? saying. You might be praying, but it's at the white throne going, oh God, help me. Okay? Or it's going, oh God, help me get there. And that is 100% physiological. It has nothing to do with your emotions, or has nothing to do with your spiritual being. But because this battery gets drained out, it starts sucking the juice out of these two other batteries and has a detrimental effect on those. And so all three of these batteries affect one another. You get depressed. Depression is 100% psychological. What is the number one symptom of depression? It's lethargy. You don't have any energy. You're depressed. You don't want to get up out of bed. You don't want to get dressed. You don't want to do your hair. You don't want to get up and go anywhere or do anything. You're completely just void of any energy and strength. But depression is this. So because this is drained down, it begins to pull off of this battery and this battery. How do you feel spiritually when you're depressed? Your hope is gone. Joy is gone. Faith is almost completely absent, all because of one battery that was drained in. We as Pentecostals, one God people, are really good at dealing with this one right here. We're really good at dealing with this one right here. And this one, we're okay somewhat at dealing with this. We're starting to deal with this one, but we're horrible at dealing with this one. And so let me ask you, if you're in school and you missed 33% of the test, and you got a 66, what was your score still? D? You still didn't pass the test, okay? Unless your instructor accepted a D. And so if we're failing miserably in one of these areas, then we're still not loving the Lord. So it all goes back to loving God. His commandment to us, with all of our heart, with all of our soul, and all of our might. You think he just said this? Just because he was like, let me come up with that as well. No, there's a very distinct reason why he came up with this information about loving God. And so I want to talk about ways how to walk in balance with these three areas from a complete holistic approach for you people who minister and serve in the church, and you minister and serve in your families, you minister and serve at your work, to help create a very balanced, worthy perspective and way to be able to address life so that you can fulfill the greatest commandment according to the Lord Jesus Christ himself, to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. Okay? The first thing, and I have tons of research to back all this up. This lecture takes me about 3 hours to give in a classroom setting, and so you're just going to have to trust me when I tell you there's research out there that supports it. Okay? Number one thing that helps strengthen the physical battery, what we're going to look at is what charges the battery, not what drains it, okay? So the Bible tells us that we are to focus on those things that are positive, not the negative. And focusing on the negative is so much easier. Oh, sorry. Thank you, Brother Sparks. You're the greatest promotions director that the UPC has nationwide. And so focusing on the problem. Our nature is to focus on negative. This is why spreading gossip is so much easier than spreading the gospel. Okay? Because we focus on negative. So we're going to focus on some positive things. Research out there says the number one way to strengthen and charge your physical battery is pretty much a curse word to most Pentecostals, called exercise. Exercise. And I'm not talking about jumping to conclusions, or running around in circles, or flying off the handle, okay? I'm not talking about, and some of you might get a little bit of exercise when you worship at church. If you're in a real worshipful church, you know, you run the aisles a couple times, you get your exercise. They say it's 3 times to 30 minutes each week. That if you just get out and start moving 3 times a week for 30 minutes, it's enough exercise to begin to do some things in your physiology that's very beneficial. It releases endorphins in your brain that help serotonin, that make you feel better emotionally. It releases dopamine in the brain, which helps you feel better emotionally just by exercising. The number one thing that any psychologist or therapist will tell you if you come into their office depressed or dealing with anxiety is this right here: exercise. It is the number one thing that helps relieve depression symptoms, okay? And it charges your physical battery. The second thing is another horrible word for most Pentecostals: diet. And the interesting thing about diet, it's not the South Beach diet or the all-protein, no-carb diet or what other fancy diets are out there. It is simply this: moderation. Moderation. Most meals that you go out to get when you go out to eat has enough calorie content for two adults. And then you add a soda or whatever onto that. And so, diet. If you drink anywhere from 4 to 5 bottles of water every day, and you did not exercise, and you still continue to eat the same amount of food you eat right now, you will lose about 2 to 3 pounds a month. Doctors say that most Americans live their life at a mildly dehydrated state and don't have the fluid in their body to wash out all the toxins and negative things that we put in our body. So diet is absolutely essential. And the number one and number two killer of men and women in America today is heart disease and stroke. Heart disease and stroke. You know what the number one and number two preventable diseases are in America today? Amazing, isn't it? Heart disease and stroke. And what are the two things that prevent those two things? Diet and exercise. Let me ask you this. God has given you so many years to be on this earth, to pray for your family, to serve the people of your church, to reach the people of your community. And what are you going to say to God that if because you fail to do this and you fail to control this, you cut your life short by 10 years? You cut 10 years of prayer for your grandchildren, 10 years of prayer for your children, 10 years of ministry short to God's kingdom, and you cut it short by 10. 10 is a minimum. Some people cut it 15 to 20 years. What are you going to say to God when you get to heaven and there are hundreds of people that are going to hell because you couldn't choose between a cheeseburger and a salad? Or because you couldn't choose between a glass of water and a Coke? These decisions, I had a Coke right before service. These decisions about this are feel like they're anti-Pentecostal. We disregard them so often, but these are decisions that we make, one little decision every single day that has the potential to cut our life short, which is cutting short the stewardship of this body. If this body belongs to God and this is the temple of God, then we've got to do these things right here to be wise stewards of His temple, of this belongs to Him. Number three, the third thing you can do to help strengthen that right there, it's a couple of things. It's doctor visits, vitamins, medication. Some of you, just because you were dealt a genetically bad card, deal with things like diabetes or high cholesterol. I struggle with high cholesterol because I got that genetic card from my mother. I also struggle with a hypercoagulatory blood disorder. So I got to take blood thinner every single day. I got to take some fish oil pills to help deal with my high cholesterol. And so I have to take these things to help bring my body into the balance that it needs to be so I can live a longer life. And we need to go to the doctor every once in a while. And we need to have that annual physical medical checkup. We need to listen to what that doctor has to say. You know, it's hard for us folks who are older to walk into a doctor's office and the person who walks in to examine you has got to be in their 20s. And you're looking at them going, you know, I've got to know more than you do. Guess what? You don't. They've got that degree, and they're charging you a whole lot of money for a reason, because they've got the knowledge of what you need to do. And this is an aspect of submission. Your doctor tells you to lose weight, or to diet, or to take medication. How do you know that's not the voice of God speaking through that man or woman to help you lengthen your life? Submit yourselves unto one another. Well, he's just talking about the body of Christ. How do you know that that doctor's not a believer? And so just submission. Let me move along. We will look at what drains this battery just for a little bit, because we've got to point out something that's very, very obvious. Number one thing that drains the physical battery is something that probably every single one of us is dealing with right now: lack of sleep. How many of you, the 2 or 3 o'clock hour is your nap time? It's mine too. Okay, lack of sleep. It is the number one thing in our country that creates physiological and psychological difficulties. When you sleep is the only time your brain and your body produces a chemical called serotonin. Serotonin is that chemical that makes you feel good. And it's only when you get about from 6 to 8 hours of sleep that you actually produce the level of serotonin that's necessary. So you're getting less than 6 to 8 hours of sleep a night. What's happening is you're slowly producing less and less serotonin in your brain, and you're leading yourself into a state of depression. It begins mildly at first, and then it becomes advanced and gets progressive. And so you've got to get adequate sleep. Before the light bulb was created, people in America slept anywhere from 10 to 11 hours a night. Because when the sun went down, they weren't going to bed soon after that. And when right before the sun came up, when the rooster started crowing, they woke up. When the light bulb was invented, Americans lost 4 hours of sleep. We went to an 8-hour sleep cycle. When the phone was invented and the computer was invented, throw me my phone. Just throw it. We lost another 2 hours because we sit up and we look at this phone and we check our social media and we get on the computer. And so now the average American only sleeps 6 hours every night. And so we've progressively lost amount of sleep that's necessary for us to recharge this battery. Interesting fact is, you know, that little light that lightens up your screen, your brain, whenever you look at that light, it interprets it as artificial sunlight. And so when your brain sees that light, what it does is it stops the production of a chemical called melatonin, which helps you get good sleep. And so you think, well, I'm going to read a little bit before I go to bed. And so you read. And your brain says, oh, the sun's out. That there's enough light coming in to artificially stimulate and stop the production of melatonin. So you turn it off and try to go back to sleep, and you can't. Doctors are now saying that you should not read anything that comes off of a screen for close to 2 hours before you go to bed. 2 hours before you go to bed. Especially if you have a hard time sleeping. Now there's some of you in this room, you can look at the brightest screen there is and put your head down on the pillow and still fall asleep. And there's the other group in this room that hates you for that. But if you have a problem with sleeping, you need to get your face out of the computer and out of the phone for up to 2 hours so your body can begin to prepare you for taking a nap. Okay? And so, let's move on to the emotional battle. There's a saying in our country, if mama ain't happy, ain't nobody happy. That statement is not about how mom's a tyrant. Okay? It's about how she's a relational person. And as a woman, she's a relational person. She wants to know that everything's right in her world. And so, the number one thing that charges this emotional battery is time with primary relationships. Meaning the people most important to you. Time with your family, time with your spouse, time with your children. So that you know that everything is going good. Games, fun times, interactions, conversations, connections. It helps charge this emotional battery to where you've got some juice in there that it charges. You know, hey, everything's good in my life. My world is okay. And it charges me there. The second thing is go for a walk. Go for a hike. Ladies, go shopping. Okay? You can tell your husbands, a marriage family therapist told you to go shopping to make yourself emotionally feel better. Okay?
Fishing work for guys.
Excuse me?
Fishing or hunting work for guys.
That's what we're fishing on the works for guys. That's why I said tonight. What this is about getting out of your four walls. Emotionally, when this battery starts depleting, we lose the emotional energy to get up and go out. So when it starts depleting, instead of being reactive about it and waiting until you get depressed to go out and do something, you schedule times where you're actively going out into your world. You're getting out and you're going shopping. You're getting out and you're going for a walk. You're going for a hike. You're going planning trips to the grocery store if you enjoy that. It's about getting out of your world so you're not just in these four walls. Because the more time you spend in your four walls, the more depressed you become. Oh, I've got to do this thing. Oh, I've got to do that. Oh, I still got this thing. And you keep depleting that energy and you start thinking about all the stuff I got to do at church. And the stuff I got to do here. The stuff I got to do there. And what happens is you end up not going anywhere. You have to force yourself out of your four walls into your world. Number three is stress management. And I'll be honest with you, I hate that word, stress management. But why can't I just avoid stress? How come I have to have it? What do you mean I have to manage my stress? Because stress is going to be a part of your life regardless of who you are. Anybody here ever cook a pot of spaghetti? Cook a pot of spaghetti. Hey, you get the water boiling, you throw the noodles in there, throw a little bit of salt in there, and it starts to boil. And as it starts to boil, this white foamy bubble start rising to the top. Okay? And probably like most of you, you get busy doing other stuff around the kitchen. And so you turn around, you see that boil all the way to the top. What do? Okay, you probably jump out, you're blowing on it, you're fanning on it, you're stirring it, you know, you're turning it down, you're doing all kinds of things to stop it from boiling over. Because if it boils over, it makes a mess, doesn't it? And it's hard to clean that stuff off. And so it boils over. Your stress is the exact same way as that pot of spaghetti. You've got things that are putting pressure on you internally. And you feel that, and it keeps rising. And you realize it keeps rising, but you keep telling yourself, I can handle this. I can deal with this. I can deal with that moron at work, or I can deal with that idiot at the church, or whatever, I mean, that brother at the church, you know, whatever. And so you keep dealing with it, thinking that you're going to be okay. And the reality is that most of us don't boil over at church. We don't boil over at work. We don't boil over at school. We come home and we boil over. And when we boil over, we make a mess at home. And someone might say, you know, someone will make a statement to you. What are you cranky about? And you're like, nothing. You know, I wasn't cranky at all until you asked me that question. Now I'm cranky. And if you've ever felt that way, the problem was you were at the top of a boil and your facial expressions, your tone of voice, and everything about you says, I'm about to boil over. And somebody says, what are you upset about? Oh, I wasn't upset, but now I'm upset. And now your question, you were about to boil over. You've got to learn to manage your stress by disconnecting from your world. Number one thing that researchers today say causes heightened levels of stress, this wonderful thing right here. And not just this, but the things that you have on this. How many of you are on social media? Social media. Even Facebook came out about a month, 2 months ago and said, hey, we think we're bad for your health. We're just not really quite sure the total ways that we're bad for your health. So we're studying this right now. I mean, for Facebook to make this statement, Social media connects you with people that you really don't care about. And you read about all the stuff going on in their life, and what does it make you feel about your life? Lonely, sad. You know, my wife said the other day, you know, for Valentine's, all you saw was the people that got flowers and went out to eat, you know, and got chocolate and all these wonderful things. Nobody posted on there, oh, my wife forgot to get me, or my husband forgot to get me flowers this year. Oh, we're at Texas Bible College, you know, for an event tonight, you know, and so we're not really, you know, you don't read every once in a while, you might read something like that from somebody true, but most of the stuff you read is positive stuff, and it makes you more depressed about your own life. There is research out there from Boston University that shows a direct correlation with the amount of time you spend on social media with elevated stress levels. And elevated depression and anxiety levels as well. The more time you spend on social media, the greater likelihood you are to deplete this emotional battery. And how many of us get up in the morning and that's the first thing we do? How many of us, we go to bed, that's the last thing we do? And I begin to wonder if God is thinking that social media has become the new God, and he's just a little God we pick up when we're completely maxed out and need someone to strengthen us. Because, and you've probably heard preachers say this a lot, and I'm just going to jump on it real quick. You know, we need to put more time of our face in the book versus Facebook. And so, and that's probably over here, though, but stress management. The more time you spend on there, when we look at what drains this, I just kind of talked about that a little bit right now with social media, but not disconnecting from your world. GE came out with a research study a while back. GE is the foremost trainer of corporate American employees. Most of the Fortune 500 CEOs, CFOs, all come from GE, or a large statistical group of them. And so they're known for their upper management training. About 4 years ago maybe, GE said this to all their middle management and above. We do not want you engaging in work after work hours. We don't want you answering text messages. We don't want you responding to emails. We don't want you doing anything to do with work after you walk out of their office. Because they did the research and they found out that the employees that stay connected to work via email or text messages were actually less productive than the employees that spent a good solid 8 to 10 hours and then left. They were less creative. Their departments brought in less revenue. The employees that worked for them were less happy and less satisfied. And so those that did their 8 hours of work were more productive all around the arenas of work. So why should you stay connected to your church, to your work, to anything 24 hours a day? You've got to learn to disconnect. You've got to learn to take time to disconnect from the things in your world. Because not disconnecting is the number one thing that's going to drain this battery. You don't feel like you can get away. Everywhere you go. How many of you like cruises? Like to go on a cruise? Okay? I love cruises. And it's not, there's a ton of stuff that I can do. I'm a Pentecostal, there's not much I can do on a cruise. Okay? What I love about a cruise is I can't get any cell phone reception. I can't even get an email. And I don't go pay for the email access. No one can get a hold of me for like an entire week, and I love it. It's disconnecting every once in a while. And it's connecting with these people right here. You got 7 days on a cruise with people that are important to you, hopefully, that you connect with. You know, the thing that just baffles me is these Pentecostal cruises. Why would you want to go on a cruise with 100 other ministers? I don't get it, but some people do. Oh, it's being alive. I'm sorry. Pentecostal cruises are awesome and wonderful. You should all go. Brother Sparks endorses them wholeheartedly and thinks they're great. But you got to disconnect. You got to disconnect from your world, or else it's going to drain you. Now let's jump over into the spiritual. Most of us are already good at this one. But I'll tell you how important this is. Forget how important this one is. As a marriage family therapist, I was licensed in California. California has got to be one of the biggest anti-God states that there is. And the California Board of Behavioral Science tells me that whenever I'm dealing with extremely difficult issues, such as someone who's wanting to kick an addiction, drug or alcohol, or a sexual addiction, someone's wanting to change a lifestyle behavior, maybe they're homosexual and they want to go to being straight, that I cannot work with them. I'm not educated or skilled enough. I have to refer them over to a spiritual advisor. Even they labeled those issues as primarily spiritual. And so I got to refer that person to someone who is of the faith, a minister, a priest, whatever it might be. When you look at statistics on drug and alcohol recovery, the greatest drug and alcohol recovery program out there that's evidence-based, remember that keyword, evidence-based, has a 13% success rate. It operates out of Southern California. And it's a 13% success rate. That's a pretty low success rate. But that's the best one they have out there that's evidence-based. AA, which looks at a higher power, whatever higher power you happen to choose, has a 33% success rate. So 20% higher than the best evidence-based program because of believing in some higher power. Now, it just so happens the best drug and alcohol recovery program in the United States, last I looked, is in Southern California also. It's a group called Teen Challenge, which is hardcore, 100% faith-based. From the moment you wake up to the moment you go to bed, you're reading your Bible, you're involved in services, you're serving people around you. It has a 78% success rate because of this component right here. They will tell you that this has some kind of effect that they're not able to even analyze from a research perspective that helps people that have problems. And you and I know what that is. You and I know what that is. It's God. It's God. And so we've got this one down pretty good. The problem where this comes in for us is we get to a point in ministry, we stop thinking we need to do the fundamentals and the essentials here, and we just serve more than we spend time with the master and get charged in that battery. So number one thing here is personal devotion. You taking the time to get into that place of prayer with God. You taking the time to get into the Word of God. You know, when I was a young man growing up in church, I always heard you had to read the Word of God. You had to read the Word of God. You had to read your Word. You had to get it. You had to read your Word. And then I started studying the Word of God as a young minister, and I realized all the people in the Old Testament, 99% of them, even in the New Testament, they didn't read the Word of God. They didn't. They were listening to somebody else read the Word of God. They were hearing it. You know, from an educational research, says we learn one of three ways. We are either, we're visual learners, we see it and we remember it, and then we read it. We're auditory learners, we hear it and we remember it. Or we are what they call, we do it, we got to practice it. Hands-on.
Kinesthetic.
And we actually got to do it to be able to learn how to do it. The largest group of that is auditory. That when you hear by, you know, I love it when I hear the Bible and he's got music in the background and it's Alexander Scorby. God said, let there be lights. You know, and nothing back down. You just remember, I remember that. I don't know about some of you. Don't force yourself into a new, in the arena of biblical wisdom, principle of reading the Word of God because somebody else said you have to read it. If you remember it better by hearing it, listen to it. Your phone will read it to you. And listen to it. Let your kids listen to it if that's how they learn. So in your personal devotion, it's your personal relationship with God. What works best for you? Is it driving to work and praying? Is it getting in a prayer closet and praying? Is it walking back and forth? I've got ADHD, I'm almost positive. Because when I pray, I've got to walk. I got to walk back and forth. Every once in a while, I might be able to pray while laying down or sitting down. But I got to like lift my hands in the air and, you know, like move my legs around and do all kinds of crazy things to keep myself focused. So you and your personal devotion, do what's good for you and your relationship with God. Don't feel like you have to copy somebody else's relationship. Number two, serving others. You already do this on some level. I remember as a young man coming and being reluctant to share prayer requests. But we had a leadership meeting that I would often come to, and the day I had a prayer request, another brother in our group would say, "Please pray for my wife. She's got cancer." And instantly, my prayer request was absolutely nothing. Because why? In light of what other people are dealing with, sometimes all I can say is, "God, I'm blessed. I am blessed." You get outside of your four walls, or maybe even your church, and start ministering to people at convalescent homes, people at hospice homes, people that don't have, the poor, the down and out. You start ministering to some of these people. Man, it changes your perspective on the scope and how big your problems really are. All of a sudden, you stop and it changes your perspective and say, "God, you are so good to me." And serving and ministering to others is the only thing that helps this. And it charges you up. It says, "Yes, God is with me. God is for me. Who can be against me?" And you don't do that oftentimes by sitting in the church doing it. And I know music ministry is serving. But sometimes all you do is see the same old people over and over and over again. We've got to get outside the four walls and minister to people that really, that you're not going to benefit anything from ministering to. They're not going to gain anything financially from them, but you just serve them because you know it's the right thing to do. When Jesus walked to the sheep gate at the pool of Bethesda, there was nothing any of those people could do for him. He knew he was walking into a mess. But he chose to go to that location to serve someone who could not help him. And we need to be Christ-like and go to places where we can serve. Amen. Number three, group studies or retreats. Things that help get the Word of God into you from a group perspective. You know, you gain something from a ladies' prayer meeting that you don't get at the all-church prayer meeting. You gain something from a men's retreat that you don't get from, you know, just going to a church service on Sunday. You get interaction with other people in the body of Christ in a small group setting that helps you build relationships. And in order for you to have unity in your church, or unity in your family, you've got to be able to connect with the body of Christ. You want to know what? My mom and dad probably didn't have the most influence on me when it came to religious and church development. It was other people in the church. And spending time with other people in the church. And going around with other people. I was first generation, so if you're not first generation, this don't apply to you. But coming in as a teenager, having those relationships with other people in church that help strengthen me, and you need that to strengthen that battery. Okay? What drains this? Number one thing that drains it, it's called burnout. Burnout. You got more going out than what you have coming in. You're giving constantly. Constantly giving. It's disconnecting from these spiritual roots. Disconnecting from these spiritual roots. There's a research study out there that looked at the influence of religion And they wanted to see what effect religion had on people in a positive perspective. Well, they found out an interesting thing. It was a longitudinal study. It was a study that was done over 20 years. They found out something interesting in this group that began studying, that those that left their religion, what impact it had on them. They found out that those that left religion and did not replace it with some other form of religion, they didn't just change their religion, they just walked away from God. They backslid. They found out that those people had higher rates of depression, higher rates of anxiety, higher divorce rates, higher psychosomatic or physiological sicknesses in their body, that across the board, everything they could measure from a research basis, the people who walked away from God were worse off even than those who never had any kind of faith. And the researcher made this statement, and he says, we can't confirm this by our research, but it's almost as if those that disconnect from their faith, there's something internally in them that says, there's something wrong in me. There's not something right. I'll never be good enough. I can never have something good. I can never have something worthy. It's almost as if the doors of our church should have this sign on that says, warning, the minute you come in here, it's going to change your life forever, either for the good or for the bad. And so disconnecting, you cannot disconnect from your spiritual roots. And so this are things that we do to keep ourselves loving God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, and with all of our mind. And we look at this list, we're like, man, this is a massive compilation of things that I need to change. But remember this statement, I can't go back and start again. But I can start today and make a brand new win. I can start today and change one thing in each area of my life that will ultimately change the quality of my life and the end of my life. And if I'm going to love God, that word love is a verb, just ask DC Talk. It's a verb. It says, I've got to do something. Love means I do something to serve God with my body. I take care of it. I manage it. I'm a steward for Him. Love says, I do something to care for my mind, my heart, to make sure that when I get older, our bishop right now, Brother Cole, he's 87 years old, and the man is sharp. He's sharp. And I'm getting up there, so at 87, I think, now I hope my mind is as sharp as his when I get that age. I hope I'm not like just drooling all over myself and, you know, having a hard time. And so getting yourself and doing brain training exercises that help your brain fight off things like Alzheimer's or Alzheimer's and dementia. There are literally games and apps that you can download to your phone, you can download to your iPad, that you can play these games 5 minutes a day, and they're designed by researchers to help your brain cognitively stay active and fight off the effects of Alzheimer's and dementia. And so I'm loving Him by doing those things. And I'm like, am I loving Him with all of my heart? The Bible says in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, that ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost is come upon you. And being that I'm speaking in this group, I've got 2 minutes left. Knowing that I'm speaking to this group of people that constantly give. I played drums for 7 years. We lost our drummer at church one time. And I learned how to play drums as a kid. And nobody at the church knew I knew how to play drums. And we're standing there and we have no drummer. And I'm standing next to my wife, and at this point I says, I can play that song. And she goes, what? And I'm like, yeah, I can play that song on the drums. She goes, do it. And I don't know if she was joking or she was serious. I left the pew and I got on the drums and I played the song. And we haven't had a drummer for months. Guess what? I don't think I got off those drums for the next 5 years. Every service, every altar call, you know how dry I was spiritually. Not ever being able to be in an altar call. And I'm talking to a group of people right now that without a doubt One of these batteries in your life, you look at it, and it's drained. It's depleted. And you're going, what am I going to do? How am I going to do that? Yeah, it might take a little while. But I do know this, that we serve a God that's able to do exceedingly abundantly above that which we ever asked or think, that says unto us, if you need wisdom, ask, and I will give wisdom unto you liberty. What kind of a God would not answer a prayer that says, God, I want to serve you and love you more with all of my heart. Would you give me the wisdom? Would you give me the strength to come out of the depression I'm dealing with? God, I want to serve you more with my spirit or my body. Would you help me have the wisdom to begin to move forward and love you more with all of my heart? And I'm talking to some people that are depleted and are empty. And I want you to do me a favor. If it's appropriate, I want you to close your eyes and bow your head and take the hand of the person next to you. Ladies, men with men. And I want you to pray for one another. That the Spirit of the Lord will strengthen them right now. That the Spirit of the Lord will touch them and help them. Jesus, in your name, we come to you, Savior. God, we know that you are the God of abundance, that you are God of strength. Lord, we're asking you right now, Lord, that your power would touch my brother, would touch my sister, and would move on them in a great way, oh God. I pray, Lord, help us to learn how to walk in balance with you, Lord, to walk worthy of the calling where we love you and serve you with all of our heart, with all of our mind, and with all of our soul, oh God. Help us, oh Lord, to charge these areas, oh Lord, of our spirits, of our hearts, of our minds, in the name of Jesus right now. Hallelujah, that's it. Oh, hallelujah. And the Spirit of the Lord is moving in this room right now. Go ahead, let that power right now begin to touch you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You felt that. Faith without works is dead. Knowledge without implementation is worthless. You need to take this home and put it on your refrigerator. Put it up somewhere you can see it. And make a decision that says, I'm going to do that. Or that this week. I'm going to start. And I'm going to become everything God wants me to become. And walk in balance. Walk worthy of His calling. Amen. God bless you. If you have any questions, feel free to. I think we got choir. Those of you who are singing in the mass choir.